Welcome to EPG Pathshala. My name is Dr. Poonam Gulalia. I'm faculty with the Tata Institute of Social Sciences. The paper which is being discussed is titled Fieldwork and Field Supervision. The module that I'm going to discuss now is titled Ethical Issues and Concerns in Fieldwork. To begin with, I would like to quote Professor A.S. Desai, who said that usually universities see knowledge generation only through research studies. But in social work, it has been realized that tremendous knowledge is generated through field experience. Keeping this in mind, I would like to say that social work education is based largely on an interrelated system of values, theories, and practice. Fieldwork in itself is an integral part of social work education, and this experience provides the social realities where the student attempts a conscious application of skills, values, perspectives, and methods in social work practice. It is the field instructors who are considered as the social work educators, and it is the quality of field supervision which is provided to you as students which has a major influence on your learning and in your growth as a professional. It is a well-recognized fact that knowledge and skills both arise from a value base which is upheld by the profession of social work. Therefore, the role of field supervision in enabling a student to learn about these professional values and its expression in the field realities is an inherent task of supervision. It needs to be kept in mind and to reiterate that society is evolving, and so is the focus and the approaches to the social work profession. Considering the rapid changes that are taking place and the transitions and the fluidity of what is right and what is wrong, what is moral, what are ethics, what needs to be done, and how problems are to be defined and redefined. All these aspects need to be dwelt on. This module, therefore, looks at the importance of inculcating values of social work in students and addresses the ethical dilemmas faced by student social workers when engaging with the field. This module also incorporates concepts of field instruction, principles, the context of fieldwork, the various stakeholders, the challenges and concerns, and of course, does an overview of the supervisory roles and processes. What is meant by field instruction? What does one mean when one uses the term field instruction? The modalities of field instruction may vary from institution to institution, from department to department, from school of social work to college of social work. But there are some common aspects which are kept in mind by all institutions of social work. Field instruction, therefore, is largely seen as a one-to-one learning process through individual meetings, through group learning exercises, both of which are accepted processes of learning. It is the emphasis that we place on individual teaching and a combination of individual and group conferences which are found to be very useful and effective. Coming to the social work values and principles, one needs to state that the core values of the profession reflect the broad perspective of the profession. It is these values which guide the student choices and actions across populations, across fieldwork settings, and across locations. The values and the ethics form the very base for the accountability one has to the people, to the society, to the stakeholders, and to the client populations. Therefore, it is extremely important that students experience the operationalization of these values in the given practice situation and also understand the challenges which they may have to face, as these would determine their effectiveness as professional social workers in the future. Some definitions are essential at this stage. What do we mean when we use the word value? Values are ideal norms which are largely accepted in society. For example, speaking the truth. These may be operationalized differently depending on the context. The second definition is that of ethics. What do we mean when we use the word ethics? Ethics are an inquiry into the principles of human action. And professional ethics are values in action or values in operation. Every decision taken in the field is ethical and value-based. Example, respecting the personal privacy and confidentiality of a client is a value. Taking the informed consent of the client is the ethical responsibility and the ethical expression of this value. Now, what do we mean by the term declaration? Declaration is a statement of principles and values which has no legal binding as such. What do we mean then by the term code? Code is a statement of principles and values which is legally binding. After having been through the definitions, one would need to go through a little bit of the history. Since there is no accreditation or licensing process for social workers in India, one needs to understand that there are no regulatory mechanisms for screening ethical practices or unethical practices in the field of social work. There is no universal acceptance of social work ethics for the profession. So, one of the major factors which needs to be highlighted here is that there is a diversity of cultures and social realities which make it difficult for only one set of values to be followed by all practitioners. However, this does not mean in any way that professional practice should not have guidelines. There are two documents which are used in social work education in India, which provide the value base for social work and also provide guidelines for ethical practice. These documents are the Declaration or the Ethics for Professional Social Workers, accepted by the Bombay Association of Trained Social Workers 2002, Mumbai, and the principles stated in the International Federation of Social Workers, besides the International Association of Schools of Social Work 2014. Coming to the core values of the profession, which are followed all over the world, one needs to understand that these include upholding human dignity of every individual and every person's right to self-determination, equality, freedom, and justice. Besides these core values, within the country, the profession is also influenced by the values which are considered important in the Indian society, wherein families and communities are important contexts for relationships, leading to more emphasis on duties rather than rights. Additionally, the humanism aspect, which had been promoted by the Bhakti movement, the Swarajya, that is self-rule, and Lokniti, that is people's policy, of the Sarvodaya movement, implying the well-being of all, are all important aspects. Clubbed with socialism, secularism, and democracy, which is promoted by the Constitution, one needs to understand that all these values shape social work values in India. Coming from the values, one needs to move to the aspect wherein the principles of social work include inherent worth and dignity of human beings, doing no harm to others, respect for diversity, and upholding human rights and social justice. All these are important to be understood in the context of the fields of practice where you are placed for placement. The other document which needs to be referred to here is the Human Rights Document. which emphasizes the right to be human and the interconnectedness of all humankind. One needs to keep in mind that all rights and entitlements are interrelated and interdependent components of one generative principle, that is, human dignity. The document on human rights reaffirms the human right to development. Now, what do we mean by development? Development is based on the principles of democracy, sustainability, and people-centered participation. Cumulatively, social justice refers to the manner in which society allocates resources for its members. Therefore, human rights are essential to peace, and peace is the realization of human rights. Keeping in mind a rights-based approach to social work, one also needs to keep in mind certain basic aspects of our own lives, which are love and compassion. The powerful force of love and compassion need to be emphasized in our field situations, as these are life-promoting values. It is an important source of empowerment of individuals and challenges and resists domination of one from another. This gets reflected in the field, whether they are institutional settings, community groups, or group workspaces. The naming of the world, which is an act of creation and recreation, is not possible if it is not infused with love. Love is an act of courage and not of fear. So we need to remember that love is a commitment to the other, to the client, to the stakeholder, to the community group. And it is also a cause of liberation. Therefore, love must generate other acts of freedom, otherwise it is not love. This aspect needs to be placed in the context of social work. It has been seen that while historical forms of injustice such as caste, class, and gender continue to prevail in our society, there have been a sharp increase in inequalities and oppressive forces in the last decade. The increased infiltration of culture, religion, technology, and even media in everyone's life has both constructive and damaging effects on the lives of people. They impact our personal lives as much as they impact the lives of the clients we interact with. We need to also remember that consumerism has impacted us as much as it has impacted our stakeholders. Consumerism, a culture of instant gratification, has created impatience and violence and has permeated the lives of ordinary people. Killings as a strategy for problem solving and violence has been legitimized in different spaces. All these become causes for concern and causes where values and ethics are questioned by a student social worker. Coming to the micro and macro linkages, one needs to understand that these are deeply enmeshed today and that the need is not just to indigenize but also to internationalize. At the same time, one needs to understand that there is a gradual increase in initiatives led by people, in social movements which uphold human rights, and there is a growing civic engagement of people wherein solidarity is being undertaken to address issues of oppression, to address issues of discrimination and deprivation. Emerging perspectives have been recognized in social work, and Dominelli has spoken of anti-oppressive practices. Feminist practices have been spoken of by Menon. A strengths-based perspective have been spoken of by Saliby earlier, and green social worker has been propagated by Dominelli in as early as 2012. Overall, there is a gradual increase in consciousness towards building a humane and sustainable society, and theorists have connected with practitioners to work on this consciousness. It is in this context that social work as a profession is evolving and challenging to meet the demands of the external environment. Keeping in mind the current context of consumerism and materialism, we also need to appreciate that there are various stakeholders in the field whom you will connect with as a student learner. Their values and principles may be questioned by you, but they may be having reason for retaining their own values and retaining their own perspectives in the field. The perspective and the value framework of the agency where you are placed, the placement that you have, and the perspective of the institution of social work education needs to be in tandem. Both need to be in congruence for the student's learning to be effective. One needs to appreciate that certain problems of integration between the agency's values and those of the institution of social work education could include one or more of these. One, the primary goal of the fieldwork agency is to meet the objectives of the agency concerned, wherein the training of students sometimes plays a peripheral role. Secondly, fieldwork supervisors, who are also agency staff in some cases or agency personnel, have multiple roles other than supervising students. Thirdly, the close relationship between academics and practice, between academic curriculum and fieldwork curriculum, is sometimes difficult to maintain. Fourthly, the curriculum planning is done by the institution of social work education, who are responsible to provide a wide range of information and skills to suit the overall needs of the profession. So, what are the challenges and concerns which emerge in this regard? In this dynamic and quick-changing world, there are several complex dimensions to values and ethical actions which emerge in the field. These include the changing concepts of family, the changing concepts and the changing nature of relationships, the range and the fluidity of gender relationships, and a lot of other issues which are rights-based issues, whether they are the rights of children, women, or other marginalized groups. Within the human rights perspective, what then is the universalist and cultural relativism approach, and what does universalist theory state? Universalist theory believes that by being human, we have rights and these rights must be protected. Cultural relativism states that human rights are specific and are decided by the cultural milieu and the way of living of a particular target group. Hence, those outside that culture should not intervene. Example, if the culture of a particular community accepts genital mutilation, then no outside principle or force should overrule this cultural norm. In other spaces, if accepting dowry or child marriage is the cultural norm, it would need to be respected. In this aspect, the debate is ongoing. When the NGO Declaration on Human Rights of March 1993, which was an outcome of the Asia-Pacific NGO Human Rights Conference held in Bangkok, had stated, "As human rights are of universal concern and are universal in nature and are universal in value, the advocacy of human rights cannot be considered to be an encroachment upon national sovereignty." Moreover, the Nobel Peace Prize winner Shirin Ebadi of Iran said in 2004 that cultural relativity should never be used as a pretext to violate human rights. There also exists a hierarchy of values in every society, and we need to question whether we want to place collective justice over individual justice in this case. Why are values so important, and how do you think they can operate if awareness does not exist? It is to be noted that values are operative only when a student has the knowledge of the values behind their own actions and is aware of the alternatives. If actions are undertaken in the field due to coercion or are mandatory, these actions do not spring from values. Example, if a desperately poor kidney donor may agree to sell her kidney to feed her children without knowing that she is a pawn in the organ donation market, then needs to be questioned by the student social worker. Hence, she cannot be labeled a criminal in the organ sale racket. Similarly, in another case, if a parent who so to say sells his or her child to a child trafficker with the belief that the girl will have a better life in another city or in another country, the parent may be ignorant or may have no other choice, as he or she may not be able to provide for, fend for the girl's basic minimum standards of survival. Having exhausted all other means to earn a livelihood, a widow may have no choice but be forced into prostitution to feed her children. Hence, a major goal of social work is to enable persons or populations to increase their range of choices in life. Another important aspect which needs to be kept in mind is that the values of society may not necessarily be in keeping with the professional values of the profession. What does one mean when one says that? One means that there are societal values which sometimes contradict professional values. For example, same-sex marriages may not be acceptable in a particular community or in a particular country, but the social work values of freedom of choice, human dignity, and inclusion would be paramount when accepting and understanding same-sex relationship. Similarly, values would be operative when accepting a prostitute or when accepting intercaste marriages. Coming to the value of peace and non-violence in the context of the social work profession, one would need to quote from the UN Human Development Report of 1994, which states that without peace, there may not be development, and without development, peace is threatened. It further states that peace and security will not be achieved except in the context of sustainable development that leads to human security. The fact is that social work ethics uphold pro-life values, which are linked to the values of peaceful coexistence, non-hierarchy, and non-discrimination. Thus, education for sustainable development, such as education for conflict resolution, for multicultural education, for developmental education, or for human rights education, non-violent communication are all termed as peace education. This requires healing and reconciliation of communities and is a value which needs to be accepted and appreciated by you as student social workers. Speaking of peace education, one major goal is to teach how people can be in conflict while maintaining their dignity and the dignity of the other. Violence in all forms is an assault on human dignity and is not accepted as a professional goal. The current form of development itself becomes a significant cause of human rights violations. Way back, Gandhiji knew that the desire to amass wealth when resources were limited would inevitably lead to violence, both at the individual and societal levels. This is a value which we continue to practice. Hence, he pleaded for a life of simplicity and self-control. There may be instances in the field when people whom you engage with may advocate violence, when they themselves experience violence or unjust oppression. The social worker would then need to facilitate a dialogue with the people to discuss the pros and cons of their actions. the people may finally decide to go ahead with their planned strategy. For example, a woman's group may decide to beat up a man who indulges in wife beating. Here, the student social worker needs to understand the contextual violence in which such groups use force and allow them the right of self-determination. There may be certain social action strategies which you may have heard of, advocated by Saul Alinsky, which aim to humiliate and ridicule the powers that be. Strategies such as gheraus and dharnas for long periods of time may be viewed as violent. Even verbal violence, threats, and such others may be accepted strategies for mass action in case communities resort to these. Therefore, what seems to be clear is that non-violence as a value is upheld and physical harm to others is not used as a strategy in social work. However, the norms for more subtle forms of violence seem to be used. Coming to the right of self-determination, social workers are an influence on people's lives, and the extent of influence depends on factors such as the quality of relationship and the nature of engagement. However, clients and people have a choice whether they wish to be influenced by the social worker or others like their family members, religious leaders, or political leaders. The practice of self-determination enables people to make their own decisions based on the choices they have, and we need to respect their decisions. Keeping in mind the values of the profession, the most important behavior expected of a supervisor is that of role modeling the values through their own behavior in the field. Supervisors can be a great inspiration for the student and can keep the student motivated towards effective practice. How is the dignity of an individual demonstrated in the agency? It could be as basic as the way he or she is seated, their body language, the way they relate to stakeholders, the way they conduct themselves. In a group meeting, the supervisor may model behavior which can be picked up by a student to understand what values are practiced and what need to be the role model. Some of the behavior traits could be the practice of openness, taking the student along with them through the process of self-learning and reflection, demonstrating resilience in times of crisis, showing empathy and humaneness when dealing with clients, practicing authentic dialogue when speaking with stakeholders, maintaining non-hierarchy when relating to paraprofessionals, and maintaining high standards of practice of one's own work. These are all examples which enable students to practice values in the field. By showing respect to all stakeholders in the agency and in the field, by maintaining accountability at all times, by undergoing the process of self-reflection, the student can learn the best practices in the field. The use of verbal and non-verbal cues also helps students to understand the meaning of value-laden concepts. Words are often value-laden, and this is seen in the changes over the years in the social work vocabulary. The social work profession has been making efforts to modify its language to express a more humane meaning, from disabled to differently abled, and using more gender-sensitive language. Accountability and transparency are the other aspects which need to be highlighted in collaboration with the values in the field. The supervisor can guide the student on what is happening to the learner and continue to maintain a stance of lack of elitism by not keeping a distance from the people, not denying them the importance of empathy, and maintaining an expression of warmth and human behavior. It is a high commitment profession which requires high standards of practice. Operating from an informed and sensitive approach based on clear principles and values, the student can understand what it means to be a professional. It is an open practice which is guided by knowledge and learning, but not by assumptions and stereotypes. The process of ethical decision making in the field requires an identification of ethical issues, including the social work values and the duties that conflict with these values. It requires identifications of individuals and groups who are likely to be affected by the concerned ethical decision. Tentatively, you would need to identify all possible courses of actions and the persons involved in each, along with the possible benefits and the risks for each stakeholder. You would also need to thoroughly examine the reasons in favor of taking a particular stance and opposed to each possible course of action that you might consider. To summarize this module, one would need to say that contextualizing and operationalizing the values and ethics is a formidable task, where even life and death has several shades to it. In order to grapple with ambiguities in the field, paradoxes and apparent contradictions, there needs to remain a root in the social work values and in the ethical guidelines which steer the practice. Since India does not have a clear code of ethics, which are mandatory for all social workers, one needs to take responsibility for studying the documents and operationalizing the values of honesty, transparency, and participation of people. Interpretation of specific values will undergo change as society changes. However, attempts need to be made on a regular, consistent basis to arrive at a common understanding and perspective. Authenticity cannot be taught, but can be definitely enhanced by self-reflection. This is the core of the profession, where students and supervisors co-learn and jointly experience a professional conscience. I hope that this module has been beneficial to you. You have understood the contents of this module. I would also request you to read the e-text and the references which follow. I look forward to further discussion with you on this context. Thank you very much.